Okay, so I'll just do a very quick introduction of Danny, our speaker today. And Danny Phillips is based in Melbourne. I met him last year through another connection, and he's the director of Arkade, which is a customer experience agency. He's got a master's qualification in communications, focused on advertising, and he lectures for a couple of our local universities and presents on customer experience related topics at various conferences. Danny is going to talk today about some of the priorities that he sees for companies in the current times, because obviously digital commerce has become a topic of the moment, and sometimes it's just really difficult to pick what you should invest in first in terms of your time and resources.
To start my talk, I'm just going to do a bit of a case study around a little Mexican restaurant in Atlanta. This Mexican cantina called the Rose Pepper Cantina is located in Atlanta. I went to this restaurant when I was over in Atlanta a year and a half ago, visiting the MailChimp head office. And it was quite a fun little place. It had an interesting sort of letterboard out the front and had a lot of little jokes going on. But what's really interesting about, and I follow them on Instagram just because, you know, I went there, it's a little bit of an interesting thing. But what I saw over the last few weeks really sort of epitomized what it means to listen to your customers. And yeah, I know the word pivot gets thrown around a lot, but really respond and change your service offering to meet what these customers need. So I'm just going to go through this really quickly. It'll take about 5 minutes. But on the 20th of February, that Instagram account, it was a month and a half until Cinco de Mayo, which is the big sort of Mexican festival that they all get together. It falls on Taco Tuesday. So they were, you know, understandably excited about this thing happening in about 40 to 50 days from that point. Everyone's happy. It's all funny. There's not really too much to worry about out in the world. Then from there, things started changing. So on February 28, normal day, irreverent messages on their Instagram. It's a bit of fun. But then there was a tornado in Atlanta, which was pretty crazy. So they asked their community for help. 2 days later, they said, stop helping. We're getting too many donations and we can't get them to people. So follow the GoFundMe pages. It's just a little indication that they had quite a strong community that was around this little restaurant. Then what happened? The COVID-19 restrictions start to kick in Atlanta around March 14. They're saying they're still open, but they're already starting to sell gift cards. So for people that aren't comfortable going in there but want to support their little local restaurant, they're saying, hey, buy some gift cards now. And I've seen plenty of businesses go out there and use this strategy of saying, well, you know, give us your money now and we'll honor it later when you're allowed to come back out again. So really early in the piece, from an American point of view at least, they were sort of pivoting and coming up with some little concepts just to respond to the fact that the customers were asking them, how can we help you? And they said, well, you can help us by buying gift cards. That'll work. Then they start going, right, we're not a delivery business at all, but it looks like we might have to do that. So we're going to find this platform called Postmates. So they've gone out and find a platform that'll do delivery and online ordering 2 days later. But then they realized, this is a cantina. It's just not a Mexican restaurant. It's a bar. And people go there and they're known for their margaritas, and they say that we're not allowed to do takeaway liquor. So, it's a disaster. So their sign talks about calling the governor to say, go out there and petition to let us have to-go margaritas. Okay, so now it's a few days later, March 21, they're switching exclusively to call in takeout. So they're doing deliveries by Postmates. They're working on online ordering for pickup. We should try to get it launched later. Just being thankful to what's going on. Then at the end of that night, they're saying, geez, that was a bit rough. There's probably lines out the doors. They're waiting. People are waiting. They just can't handle the logistics of what they're trying to do. But, and if you go and look at this Instagram account later on, you'll see all the comments from all their followers saying, it's all cool. We understand. At least you're trying. That's what matters. 2 days later, they're allowed to do takeaway liquor. And they end up closing at 8 p.m. because they're completely sold out. So they've opened the doors to getting takeaways, but they can't even run past 8 p.m. because they're completely sold out of food and alcohol for the night, which is, that's amazing. So then they've moved to refining their communication process. So they're doing these. This is all on Instagram. This is like their website. Like you go look at their website now, they haven't changed it at all. It's probably just too hard. So they're just communicating solely through the channel that they could. And they're talking about, you know, texting in your order, arrive at your car, give us a text, and we'll, you know, all this crazy sort of stuff. But then, you know, another day later, Postmates, their delivery service, online ordering service, says, you know what, we can't let you order alcohol for our service. It's not, it's against our terms of service, so you have to stop that. So it's like, oh God. So move back to phone ordering. That'll be fine. And then the phones are broken because everyone's now gone from this nice online experience back to phones because that's the only way to do it. But check out this solution that they've got. They've said, you know what, we're just going to put a big pitcher of margarita, which is like four big cups worth, and some food for $20. Just come up and pay $40. Just come up and pay that and take it away. No ordering, just grab and go. Just within one day, they've solved that by just saying, we're not even going to even phone order this stuff. You just want margaritas, come and get them. You know, hilarious. And now they're doing a lunch, but they've been told by the government or the police saying, you can't sell whole pitchers of margarita, like of spirit-based mixes. You can't just do that. So they've changed and we can't call them pitcher packs. They're four packs of four smaller drinks. And you can see on the right there, look at the, they're all margarita pictures. They're all margarita servings. It's not food, it's all alcohol. So now they've got an online ordering system. They're like, this is 4 days later after Postmates said they can't deliver for them. And you see they've set up their pickup lines out the front of their restaurant to try to deal with the logistics there. So now the public needs more margaritas. So now they've got a delivery driver. With the delivery service, I think from an insurance point of view, they've even said this in the comments, like only the owner of the business was allowed to do the delivery driving because they weren't insured to let an employee do it. So they had to go and get all the insurance company to support that. And now they're doing the driver delivery without using this Postmates third party service. So they can get around all those, the liquor laws. I love this one. I never thought my hands would consume more alcohol than my mouth. So they've introduced socially distant ID checking. So you can see there's a I'm not sure if you can see it, but there's a MacBook with a webcam sitting facing a little table where you put your ID down, but can also see your face at the same time. So people walking up for pickup orders with alcohol can put their ID down, show their faces, and they can check that it matches without having to handle the ID cards and all that sort of stuff. So just every day they're moving through this process and turning into a well-oiled machine. So now they've got two official drivers. A day later, they've got three zones that they're doing. They're talking about shutting off delivery if both drivers are out making runs and then turn it on 10 minutes later. So it's really a hacky process. And then if you notice on the right-hand side, they're also offering, you know, yeast, gloves, rice, toilet paper rolls and paper towels. If you want just to add on a couple of toilet paper rolls to your order, you can just throw that in. Again, this is probably now less than a month since this whole thing started for them. They've sort of adapted their entire business. Then just when you thought it couldn't get any worse, someone comes and steals their tip jar from the front of their restaurant. And then, yeah, within a few hours, the whole community said, oh, well, can we donate all our tips back? Because it knows it goes to the employees. And they said, no, don't do that. Just tip us generously on the next order. And that's a very smart way of saying, you know, the next order is more important to us than the tips we might have lost with the tip jar. I thought I should show you some of their food too, because it looks pretty nice. And lastly, then roughly a week ago from today was actually the Cinco de Mayo festival. Taco Tuesday actually happens. They were able to do some sort of rough, people were allowed to come up and turn up and hang around for a little bit as long as they were socially distanced. They sort of set up this whole courtyard so people can enjoy the spirit of this sort of Mexican festival. But I love this little line at the bottom saying, yeah, we didn't choose the online order life. They didn't want to be an online, they're a restaurant. They're just a restaurant, a Mexican cantina that didn't want to be part of this whole digital thing. But the online order life chose us. And they sort of put that message out there. I think that sort of really sort of encapsulates the spirit of what these guys did. And sure enough, they sold out that night and they decided not to open for lunch the next day because they were so knackered by the whole process. And they'll regroup and launch tomorrow. So look, I think it's just a nice little summary of what I think is a nice almost a fable about a little Mexican cantina that that changed the way it worked, so that it's so that it could service its customers. So look, the talk today is really focusing on a few topics around how any business, whether you're direct to consumer, whether you're online only, whether you're a business to business type trade business, there's all of these principles that we're going to talk about really follow the same process. It's this idea that even though we're using all this technology, it's the human capital and the human approach to things that are more important than anything else right now. You see that in the example I showed, that restaurant leveraged technology every step of the way, even in the way that they communicated to their customers. But the whole point was very human, and they were willing to be transparent about what was working and what wasn't. And their customers were part of the solution. They weren't part of the problem. It's a really important thing, I think, especially when we're really focused on our own bureaucracy, our own politics, our own internal channel conflict, the way that we want to work, all our own staff, making sure they're employed. You can sort of get to a point where it's not by Tuesday or Wednesday of the week that you've actually spent any time thinking about what your customers need from you. As you saw there, they were very quick to pivot the use of their staff. So bar staff became delivery drivers. And if you're not in the restaurant game, but you're more in a retail game or in some other industry, we've seen plenty of great examples of brands repurposing the humans they have available to them to put them on the front lines, to answer phones, to jump on live chat, to respond on social media, to ring up, proactively call customers and say, how can we help you? What do you need? Sort of throwing the rule books in the bin and just being responsive. One of the things that sort of comes out of that, though, is a lot of people will say these concepts don't scale. It's really hard to scale that sort of concierge level approach. And for B2B businesses, they'll say, I'll use my CRM to actively push through this. And maybe I'll throw to a poll just asking for people out there, what sort of current customer support do you offer? Whether that's client support or end consumer support, how do you offer it at the moment? So maybe just check all the ones that you currently support for your customers at the moment, just to see how broad the spread is. You can choose multiple ones there. We're seeing a lot of explosion in brands having to quickly adapt to more channels because customers might want to or feel more comfortable talking to brands using different channels. The trap, though, is if you don't have the right systems in place, that you've got different teams answering on different channels and the message might become inconsistent. So you really need to be able to tie those different channels together so that you've got one larger team learning from all the responses, sharing those responses and those ways of working back with the sort of voice of customer team. Yeah, so email's obviously a big one. Facebook and Instagram, I think, is there's no doubt that people spend half their time, especially now that we're socially distant, on Facebook and Instagram. Interesting to see phones still well and truly up there. So often one thing we find when it comes to phone support is a lot of the quantifiable nature of the support that we get back, sort of saying, what was the nature of this inquiry? What problem, what theme is it identifying? On email and Facebook, you can generally tag these things, but phone messages don't often get quantified. They just get dealt with. So I think one thing I'd give you here is just making sure that you're quantifying at least the topics. An example might be, identify the top three or four things you think your brand could be doing better for your customers that you know is a pain point, and make sure all the customer service people in any capacity are making sure that they just straw poll the topics. Is it about availability? Is it about order delivery, tracking and delivery? Is it about service complaints or whatever else? Straw poll those things across all channels and find out what is the top three things that your customers need from you, and quickly pivot to fix those things. We've seen examples for, say, a retail brand where they would have dozens of phone calls, hundreds of phone calls a day to both their physical locations and their head office. Once we asked them to quantify, well, what is the main topic, it turned out that, you know, about 50% of store calls and 40% of head office inquiries were all about just in-store availability. Is this particular item available in my particular size or color at this location? Now, the e-commerce manager for that particular brand wasn't really interested in building features onto the website that made in-store availability or stock lookups capabilities available to the website, because that might hurt my conversion rate of my website, and I'm the head of e-commerce. But it was a good half of all inquiries, using up all that human time. So it sort of just goes to show that sometimes even the KPIs or metrics that we set for our individual departments might sort of push back some customer experience or customer solution solves that might make a lot of sense to people. So I guess that's sort of getting the data straight there, making sure that wherever possible, you're quantifying the nature of what your customers need from you. Now, one of the things about quantifying these things is that you often end up creating a whole lot of separate touch points for your customers, whether you're a direct-to-customer or B2C or B2B. So I'll chuck another poll up now that asks about which customer-facing touch points do you have, about which ones of those do you think are adequately connected to a central customer record. We see a lot of examples where they might have a store, a POS, and an e-commerce site, but the two things aren't automatically connected. And if you've got manual imports and exports that you do once a week or once a day, they don't count. So I just want to see automated connections between these systems. So if all of us are doing our, if all of us have got our strategies in order, then I'd expect all of these numbers to be even. But what we'll probably find in the results is that we'll have some spikes there where some things are connected and some things aren't. And that's probably going to be the first challenge that a lot of brands have, is that if they don't have a connected view of customer or a single view or a shared view of customer between these platforms, that it's really hard to get answers to these questions that you're putting forward. And I'm sure all of you probably that are in this boat know that, and it's on the list of things to do if it's not already connected between these systems. Another sort of way to think about this is the term single view of customer. Yeah, so everyone focuses on the email marketing database, and that's, you know, you've got your subscriber pop-ups on the website, or subscribe now in the footer, that generally is connected. But when it comes down to e-commerce accounts and store accounts and the customer service platform already having visibility of your details, there's generally a gap there. And it's a huge opportunity if you can fix that. On that theme, I think a lot of people talk about single view of customer or 360 degree view of customer being a utopia that people are looking for. One way to look at that is maybe not to think so much about a single view of customer, but focus on the idea of a shared view of customer between these systems, or a single view of brand for the customer. I think one of the things when it comes to CX strategy or digital strategy or e-commerce strategy or anything with this sort of stuff is to try to rephrase the problem or the initiative from the customer's point of view. So a single view of customer for a marketing team or the brand itself would be trying to say, I want one place where I can go as a business representative or a brand representative, get answers to questions about my customers so that I can solve my problems as a brand. What we're saying is, that's a, you know, it's a very noble cause to be fighting for, but it's often hard to get there. What we'd say is maybe revisit that whole strategy and say what my customers need is a single view of the brand. So when they do log in online and have an experience, the online system knows who they are and they can pick up where they left off. When they do send a customer service request in or give you a call, that the caller ID says, oh, this is Danny. He spends $3,000 a year, but hasn't shopped in the last 6 months. Now answer the phone call and serve that customer with that context. When I walk into store, if you're a direct-to-consumer retailer with stores and online, use the information you've got about me of what I was looking at online, what might be in my wish list, what was maybe in my cart. And rather than just sending an abandoned cart email, show that information to the store team and say, well, hi, I'm Danny Phillips. That's great. I can see you were looking at these items. Would you like to try them on? So it's the same solution, but just framed from the customer's point of view as opposed to the marketer's or the brand's point of view. I sort of call this, you know, a line we've used a lot in the past is that, you know, that marketing is often using the customers to solve business problems, but customer experience is using the business to solve customer problems. And right now, customers have got more problems than ever, especially the ones that care the most about you. And I guess the next thing we'll get to here is this idea that a lot of these strategies won't work at scale, like I was saying before, because you've got so many customers you might deal with. But all the things that I'd like you to focus more on is more the top 10% of customers or the top 20% of customers. What do they need from you? What do they really want? If you've done your analysis, you'll know that top 10 or 20% of customers probably make up at least half, if not more, of all of your revenue. So rather than trying to make sure that you've got a one-size-fits-all approach for 100% of your customers, focusing on that top 10 or 20% and saying what utility, what features, what experiences do they need us to provide to them, I think will get you in a much better place to be able to serve those people well and to decide what features that you want. I mean, I think if you looked back at the Rose Pepper Cantina, they were looking to the people that were bothered enough to jump onto their Instagram account and say what was working and what wasn't and responding accordingly. The people that just want to get Mexican once every month didn't care and didn't comment. And that's not the customers that they were serving. They were serving their best customers. So I want to see a lot more, a disproportionate effort focused on your top 10, 20% of customers than trying to solve for everyone. If anyone follows Seth Godin, who's the marketer's marketer, he speaks often about the idea of minimum viable audience. That's, it's one thing to try to grow and get as many people as possible. But if you just spent more time acquiring the sorts of customers that are similar to or look like your top 10% of customers, you can become much more profitable far quicker. It sort of leads us to this term that we're sort of toying with at the moment of a more intentional economy or a more intentional commerce. That now the new normal is probably going to be customers choosing very carefully who they spend their time, their touch points, their physical touch points, which stores they're going to visit, and their money with. And they're going to spend money on brands that have got a very focused offering that are designed just for them, rather than this sort of, you know, just try to sell the most things to the most number of people and just hope that the physics of growth and volume will make us profitable, when we see plenty of brands working very, very, very hard to open more and more and more and more stores, to have more and more and more SKUs. Revenue and turnover is growing like no one's business, but the profits are just disappearing. Be profitable and be intentional to a smaller number of people. And I think that's what the market in general wants. I want a good experiences from brands that I care about and brands that care about me specifically. Look, these are all very general, high level concepts. And like we said at the start, we really want this to be interactive. So I'm not sure if there's some questions that are coming up yet, but maybe before we get to that, let's just find one more poll to finish up this sort of the speaking at you part of the presentation, which focuses on how do you get feedback from your customers at the moment? Is it something that's always on, like continuous feedback loops, like customer satisfaction or NPS surveys, or is it more once a year, once every 5 years, once every 6 months, we go out and do a customer research project or survey? Or do you have, you know, some concept of mystery shoppers out in the field? Or do you solely rely on anecdotes from the front line to put into your head that voice of customer, so that when you're choosing what you should do next for your customers, what features do you need to build? Which of these things influence you more than others? I'll give you a couple more seconds to answer those. I'm finding that sometimes the results here sort of skew towards who's in charge of getting this sort of research. If it's marketing, marketing tends to work in a more campaign and cyclical approach. So marketing will generally skew towards customer research projects and surveys. Whereas if it's more operations focus, then we see a lot more continuous feedback loops and sort of customer service topic reports, which, you know, not surprisingly, are fairly low on the scheme of things there. Anecdotes from the front line, They are valuable. I think, I think it's one thing to quantify the results, but if you hear topics sort of build up and are smart enough to identify some common themes, then it makes a lot of sense. The only thing I'd watch with anecdotes from the front line is that you should listen to them. But before you act on them, maybe just make sure that you check that you're not just reacting, you're not just jumping at shadows. I've seen a few brands over the years that because they've got a couple of loud voices in amongst their sort of frontline network, whether it be a noisy franchise partner or a very opinionated store manager or an area manager from a B2B point of view, that demands certain things, that I've seen brands sort of disproportionately push features or strategies that make that noisy anecdote person go away. But it's not really what most of the best customers wanted. So I think that's just one thing to watch there. So look, I've covered it. I think from here, one of the other just things I'll finish up on is this idea that all these strategies that we're talking about here aren't a response to the whole COVID-19 crisis. These are things that we were talking about before this all hit. If anything, like what everyone's saying, that digital transformation and CX transformation has been thrust upon us. They didn't choose the online ordering life, it chose them. This has kickstarted our thinking forward by 5 to 10 years, probably, this whole event. But it's something that was going to happen anyway. Your customers are ready to listen. Are they ready to work with you on changing the way you work? They will try new things if you're willing to try new things. And your best customers will stick with you. And shareholders and consumers seem to be rewarding brands with a plan. You'll only have to look at over in Australia, there's a group called Accent Group. They were very quick a week or so ago to say, we will be opening stores soon. We've got a plan for dealing with it. And we're probably going to close a whole lot of stores as well. Because it makes sense, because this is an opportunity to get out of underperforming leases and rethink about what retail means to us. Their stock price went up by 20% in a day. On the news of closing several stores, like a good percentage of their store network. So it's because they had a plan and because they are public about their plan with their consumers, and they've been rewarded by their shareholders. So I think that's the point. Have a plan. It might not be the right plan, but I think at the moment the community at large is rewarding people with a plan that's public and being acted, as opposed to people are waiting for it to return to normal, or people that are waiting for the world to sort of deal them their next hands. You need to be sort of out there and pushing forward. Look, I think people hate surveys. That's going to be the thing that gets thrown around. I think by calling it, is it bad to not do surveys at all? It's sort of yes and no. I think if you treat it as a survey, and if you send a survey when you need the answer, it's always going to be sort of an imposing thing on your customers. I've decided I need to know an answer to a question for my brand on May the 14th. So I'm going to ask as many relevant customers as possible the answer to that. Now I think that's a less than ideal, because it's like when you, instead of scheduling a meeting with someone, you just call them. I'm hoping you're available to answer my call right now, because I need the answer right now. For some people, that's kind of fine. People like that. But I think on the most part, people, you need to value and respect people's time. The better way to do that, I would say, is to move to an always on strategy, where you are, whenever we interact, whenever the customer does something with us, whether it be a customer service ticket and we solve that ticket and then we ask, were you satisfied with the response? Or whenever you do make a big purchase in a store or online, thanks for making that purchase. The orders, we can see the orders now being delivered. Let us know how we went. Is there anything we could improve? So sort of talk to them when it makes sense to talk to them, because they've interacted with you, not because you didn't answer to a question. If you can do that, then you're always asking, you're always surveying, but you're never running surveys. You'll always be building up the data, and you'll see trends moving and changing, and you're responding to customers as opposed to imposing on customers. So that's, I'd say that's the way to think about it. Just always be asking, are we doing okay? And where possible, quantify those answers in a polite and relevant way, and then adjust your strategies to fit those benchmarks. And I saw there's another question about NPS surveys, which I think sort of leans into that as well. People often confuse NPS and customer satisfaction. NPS is a very specific question. It's only one question. Would you recommend us to friends and family? That's it. NPS is nothing other than that, with a special bit of maths at the end of it. I think you should be, of your best customers, you should be asking the question, depending on the cycle of your business, no more than once every 6 months, and even that's probably too often. So I'd be asking the NPS question of your customers. And again, rather than sending it on the 1st of August every year to all customers, I'd be sending it about a month after their most recent transaction with you or interaction with you. And if they interact every month, then just don't ask it if you've asked it in the last 12 months. And if it's been longer than 12 months since you've asked the question and they have interacted with you recently, you don't want to send it straight after a transaction. You want to give them a bit of breathing room so they're in sort of open space, to saying, by the way, you know who we are because you dealt with us, you know, in the distant past or in the recent past. Tell us whether you recommend us to friends or family or not. And I think if you did that, so that you're, again, always asking the NPS question to people at a consistent point in time from their last interaction with you, that benchmark would then sit. And it's a great leading indicator of the health of your entire efforts as a brand. I'd always recommend that running a first-party NPS questionnaire in that mode is much better than pulling the trigger on a set date each year or each month, because for some customers, it's not consistent from the customer point of view, because they're going to be at different parts in their cycle. They might have just bought yesterday or just had a bad experience yesterday. I think that's my sort of approach on NPS. Yeah, I think with this sort of stuff, I always like the progressive approach. When it comes to, say, join forms, if you're like, I want to join on the website, ask the thing that you need to know the most first. In order to create an account, we need an email and name and maybe gender or a preference. And then once you've pressed submit, that's great. Thanks very much. And while I've got you, can I also ask this? And you don't have to, because I've already got the information I really need. So if you use a platform or a process that allows a stepped approach, saying you bought this product, we really, as a privilege of being a known customer, us, we'd love your feedback. Giving feedback is a privilege. And for a lot of customers, they say, oh, thanks brand for asking. Because if you don't ask, maybe I'll just go complain on Facebook. So, you know, give me a place to do it direct. So please review this product you've just bought. Great. And let them submit that. And then the success page should say, well, thanks for submitting that. While you're here, would you like to also comment on, you know, the store and staff that you bought it from and the experience you had there? And if they go, yes, that's great, you can say, great, that's great. Would you also like to go review us over on Google Places reviews so we can get some, you know, good public responses to that? And they don't have to, they can always say no at any step of the way. But if they keep saying yes, it's because they're engaged and they appreciate you caring. No one's going to complain about choosing to say yes, because they can say no if they don't want to. So I'd always just do that progressive approach. And if it's a no and I'm unhappy, tell us why, if you like, and submit that straight to your customer service channel so that all the negative stuff goes straight to a customer service agent that can reply. Because if you don't, they're going to go to public. If I get crickets from you, I'll go to the internet and talk out loud with my megaphone, because generally I get a response there.
Thanks, Danny. And Dave has asked about what you think about feeding back customer responses as a summary to the customers.
Is that about servicing? I mean, if you're doing a customer service feedback, obviously the results of the question you're going to give back to the customer. But if you're saying that we've got an average satisfaction score of 22% and you make it public on the website, look, I'm a big believer in trust more than transparency. I think if you feel like you need to be transparent, I had an experience recently with a car repairs place where the whole place was plastered with their NPS score and their CSAT scores. And you could tell that every single person that worked at that place was bonus based on their CSAT scores. So, you know, they always checked, are you happy? Like, you could almost hear them say, so will you give me a good score on that survey that you're going to get tomorrow? Mm-hmm. Like, it was literally, and you see, I think even Telstra do it. It's, you know, before you go, you will get a follow-up call. Please make sure you answer it, or, you know, get in an Uber and, you know, please give me 5 stars. I think sometimes being too public with that sort of stuff can have unintended consequences to your team. So I think it's about make sure you get the balance right there. I think it's great to ask for the feedback. If you can surface it in a way that makes sense for what your brand offers. If you're trying to use mean, it's the concept of social proof. So you're trying to say, look at all the other people being happy with our service. You should be happy with us too. I think you just got to be careful that it doesn't, that doesn't come along as sort of virtue signaling or just sort of self-gratification. And it is something that benefits the consumer in that respect. So yeah, it's not a black and white answer. It's a bit nuanced, but I hope that answers the question there. Yeah, look, I think data and insights and analytics is one of these things that really can get you into a very sort of, not destructive, but just a pointless loop. It's this whole sort of what can I have, what do you want loop when it comes to the data. I think the way a person that works for a brand needs to think is you need to assume that you've got a lot of data, because you probably do. You probably have more data than what you think. And maybe it's in disparate sources, and maybe getting getting it grouped together might be harder than it should be. But if you go to the people that are in charge of the data, whether it be your IT guys or your marketing data guys, and say, where are my reports? I need insights. That's not a question. There is no report. There is no insights dashboard. Like, stop asking it for that way. What you've got to do as a practitioner, as a senior person, is go, I've got a hunch. I've got a hypothesis. I've got a question, a very, very specific question that I need answered. How many people that shopped with me for the first time last year under an account as a known customer and spent money with me last year haven't shopped in the next year? Like, how many customers really joined in 2018 and didn't shop in 2019 at all? They went to all the effort of giving us their details, giving us some money, taking home our product. They didn't just buy off the street and didn't come back next year. That's a number. It's a question that can only be answered with a number. That's the sort of approach I feel like he's still missing in a lot of businesses, asking specific questions. And it might, you might not be able to pose the question as specifically as that yet. You might go, what is retention? I feel like retention's a problem for us. So maybe we should dig a bit deeper on the concept of retention. But it's your job as a practitioner to get to a point where you can ask a specific question that's going to output a number or a chart. The insights person, the data person, can't draw the chart for you. They'll try. Do you want this chart? No, that's not what I want. And some people will go, well, I'll know it when I see it. So give me some charts, and then that'll raise more questions. And now I'll go back in again. So, but I think it's lazy. I think the real thing that I want to see from practitioners is, you know, stop and think and ask a smart question that can only have one number and answer. And you'll find that your IT guys or your data guys go, oh, that's a great question. I know exactly how I can answer that, but I'm going to have to pull spreadsheets from 7 different systems, but I know exactly how I'll do that. And they'll take pride in answering that question for you. Mm. And then once you do that every week, you go, right, great. That's great that we can get that answer every week, but we're sick of trying to pull that from 7 spreadsheets. So let's operationalize that fact and let's surface that data to my area managers and my store teams in real time, because now they can act on it. They can act on it, not at the end of the month post-mortem report. It's an active dashboard that I can use, but it all starts with questions. Mm. Everyone thinks analysis and insights is about answers. It's not. It's about questions. And questions don't come from the data guys. They come from the practitioners. So hopefully all the people that are on this call, my challenge to you is come up with at least 2 or 3 really smart questions or hypotheses that you can ask of your data and take it back to your business. Say, can someone answer this for me? Just using that example I used before about how many customers returned. For a lot of our retail brands that sell, you know, fast fashion or apparel, it's about 40%. 40% of people that went to all that effort of joining in 2018 came back in 2019. Mm-hmm. So for me, that's like, what's the point? What's the point of subscriber pop-ups? What's the point of, you know, I'll get my commission if I sign up 500 people in store this week? You know, all that effort and none of them came back and spent any money. It's ridiculous. It's a whole lot of effort for no good reason. So, if you can change, and we know that retention is a great one to focus on because it costs 20% of what it costs to acquire a customer to keep one, but I'm not seeing many brands spend a whole lot of time on retention. And so I think there's more questions coming.
It's a really good question as well, and feeds into Courtney's here. One quick example, if I may, I was speaking to a fellow who had worked at Xero, and what they'd focused in on was the indicator that each new sign up would become a paying customer. So they honed in on, and they were eventually able to identify that if a sign-up person added their bank account within 24 hours, they knew that that person would become a paying customer. So there was a very specific behavioural trigger that they could see. So what they were able to do then was focus their customer service people on their follow-up information and emails in that first 24 to 48 hours to try to get these people who have signed up and registered to add their bank account. So it was a very successful question to ask around, you know, what's the behaviour that, you know, is common amongst people who sign up to be a paying customer?
Yeah, so, yeah, and don't just report on it as a post-mortem. Once you know it, like, you know, how do I repurpose three support agents whose sole job it is to look to someone that's created an account but hasn't added their bank account and get on the phone and help them? Because if they do it, they're done. Live chat for websites too. I think, you know, if you're a retailer and you're not repurposing your store team as live chat agents right now to help people through that process, then you're missing a huge amount of money. The first thing I'd say about this sort of comment too is just like, wherever possible, never call it a customer database or a CRM or those sorts of things. Even internally, it's, of course, there is a database that stores your customer records, but increasing the number in that database is not a thing. It's a byproduct of good customer service and utility. I'll give you an example, whether it be B2B or B2C. Here over in Australia, we've got JB Hi-Fi. They've started building a loyalty program by stealth, effectively by saying, you know, these receipts that you lose that you really need to return stuff, would you like me just to send them to you by SMS? They know that email address is hard, full of typos, and they change often, whereas mobile numbers just work. So how about, and they would say, the script originally was something like, would you like me to, can I have your mobile number? And to start with, I'd say, can we add your mobile number here and you'll get an e-receipt? So it was add to the database so you get the e-receipt. But then in the end, they got rid of all that script and just said, not would you like an e-receipt, can you please tap your card and can you give me your mobile number so I can send you the receipt? And everyone goes, yep, that makes sense. Logical, done. So it's not about adding someone to a marketing database. It's adding their details to provide them with utility. That's the way. The best way to make it so that you have more people in your marketing database as a result is to provide utility to customers that only works if we know who you are. So, when I walk into a store, have you shopped with us before? Great. What was your name? Danny Phillips. I'll look you up. Oh, no, it doesn't look like I've got your details. What's your email or mobile while you're browsing? So I can get that in there and I can save anything that you like. And I can, and if you try things on, I'll save your size details in there. So even if you leave without buying something, you'll get a receipt for this interaction of what we've just done. I'm not joining you to my marketing database. And if you use the term marketing database in your head office, your store teams will use it too. And they'll say, can I join you to my database? Because apparently that's important to someone at head office. So just to throw those terms in the bin, provide utility to known customers, your marketing database will happen as a result. It's a pleasant byproduct of providing great customer experiences. I actually don't like the term CRM. I think it was, it's designed, I mean, for B2B where you're managing 20 to 200 to $2 million deals, and you need to actively manage a life cycle with a highly engaged customers, where you're tracking every single email backwards and forwards and follow-up actions for your sales teams. A CRM is a tool for sales teams. It's not a tool for customers or customer experiences. Mm. I think the best options that you've got are just to make sure that each of your systems and their touch points, so your customer service platform, your e-commerce platform, if you've got one, and again, don't put in your marketing email database anywhere near this. And your in-store experience just has a nice, simple method for collecting the identifiable information as part of the service. If it's a website, have a set of categories or features like pre-order that's only available for known customers. So log in to see this stuff. We've got some of our brands that don't do guest checkouts. I mean, and what is a guest checkout anyway? It's just the ability to not set a password. If I put my details in for an order, then you know who I am. So save that information. People just might not want to automatically opt into a marketing email, that's all. But they're definitely your customer, so they should be in your system. So I find that you could describe a CRM as a collection of tools that capture customers' information. And when you've got questions to ask of those three or four data sources, combine them on mobile or email and get your best guess answer. Yes, you might have a bit of scrappiness around the edges if someone signs up with email one over there and email two over there, but at the end of the day, those numbers won't be huge. And the customers that really engage with the brand and spend most of the money with you, they'll make it their business to make sure that the version of me that's online uses the same details that uses me in store, because I, as a customer, won't benefit unless that history is together for me. So scrap it together with the tools that you've got. You don't really need to buy a CRM. If you haven't bought one now, you don't need to buy one. What you do need to do is just come up with ways of connecting your systems so that when the customer has an experience, they or their agents, which is your store, your frontline team, can pick up where the customer left off. That's all. And you can do that with a lot of elegant hacks to get things moving. And if you ever want to get things connected together, shameless plug for Omnio.io, which is our customer data platform and customer experience platform, you can go and use something like that if you need to. But I think you can make a lot of mileage with the tools you've already got. This has been a bugbear of mine for a decade. Like, I think, I'm sure I'm going to upset people in amongst all this sort of stuff. If you are a manufacturer and you create a product that you're proud of and that customers buy, it is inevitable that you will sell those things directly to consumers. That's inevitable. And you will have to do things to make that experience as amazing as possible. If I want to buy that product, I should be able to buy it from the person who cares the most about it, which is the person that makes it, the end. So you are obligated to create an amazing direct-to-consumer experience for your absolute best customers. My family loves Carmen's gluten-free muesli, right? Now, I buy it from the supermarket, but you can buy it in bulk only from a certain number of places. And if I could buy it direct from Carmen's, directly on their website, I would. I can't yet because channel conflict and look after the retailers and blah, 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 blah. But I'm sure at some point I will be able to. And there's plenty of other FMCG brands that I can buy direct from the source. And they're not undercutting and they don't need to. I don't need it cheaper. I just maybe want it in more convenient packaging sizes and all sorts of other things. If you're a retailer that stocks other people's products, you don't sell products. You sell a service. You sell curation. You sell the ability to bring together things from all over the world and all over the internet and tell a story about them and sell them. You, as a retailer that sells other people's products, will always exist. And you shouldn't be threatened by the fact that some of the brands that you stock are willing to sell directly to some other customers that are different to your customers. Your customers buy you as a service. All you sell is service. So if you're relying on the fact that you've managed to find and source 50 different really interesting products, but you've got shit customer service, you don't answer the phone, you don't have live chat, and you don't have options for servicing those customers, then you won't exist, because it's all you've got is your service, and it's valid and it will work and it can be profitable. Minimum viable audience. If you're a little shop or a collection of shops that sells 50 different brands worth of stuff, carefully curated, you will do well. People want that. People want little mini department stores that feel like my taste, and you've stocked the different things that I find, and I'll happily give you the money any day of the week rather than going directly to the brands. But for someone else that doesn't know you, doesn't live near one of your physical locations, that love this particular product, so like for me, I like Bellroy wallets. I love them. I know I can buy them all over the place. My last one I bought from a little store that is here in Brunswick that I do appreciate and love. But the other thing I bought recently, I bought directly from Bellroy. And I might tic-tac between the two, and I'm still a good customer of the Bellroy brand. Don't fight it. Don't spend a minute dealing with channel conflict. If your retailers start getting upset at you for selling direct, just tell them to focus on service. That's their job. And if they don't like it, you know, it's a case of keeping your friends close and keeping your enemies closer sometimes. But I think really there's enough customers that want what that retailer has to offer. And there's enough ones that want what the brand has to offer. And they're often different people. And you shouldn't be, if you're spending all your time trying to deal with kickbacks and, oh, if we sell to someone that's in postcode 23, then I'll make sure you get 1.7% of that. You're spending all your time trying to service this thing. There's a great case study from I think it was a L'Oreal brand over in France, where they were really carefully trying to manage channel conflict. But they picked a particular region where they said, you know what, channel conflict doesn't exist. Everyone just fights for the best experience of the customer, and we'll see what happens. And it worked really well. They were able to prove that if the brand focused on servicing the customers that wanted to shop direct, and the retailers focused on shopping on servicing customers that wanted to shop retail, then we all made more money. If we spent all 5 hours of our week working out fair deals to maintain channel conflict, that's 5 hours you're not spending on servicing your customers. I know that's a long answer to a specific question, but I'm very passionate about it. Fight hard for your customers. Yeah. Sell direct.
So the key points that you've gone through are, you know, firstly, thinking about your human capital in the business and repurposing people who are potentially not as fully utilised at the moment as they could be in other areas. So if getting people on the phones is what's needed right now, then, you know, move some of your people over. Getting your data straight. So thinking about what sort of data you have actually got and how to ask those really good questions that people can extract from the data sources that you already have. Really honing in on what your customers, your best customers, I think, need from you right now. So, you know, really knowing who your top 10 or 20% of customers are that are most profitable to you, and trying to fulfill their needs to the best of your ability. I think it's a really great way to focus at the moment. And learning really how to make it easier for those customers to access your products and services. So regardless of what type of business you're in right at the moment, it's all about people still want my product, service, etc. How can I make it easier for them to purchase it, and how can I get it to them at a time when they're going to be more understanding that, you know, if it's delivery, it won't be within 24 hours, you know, those sorts of things, but keep them informed. And then things to think about as lockdown eases. I'm not sure we've pulled many of those out, but I think if you've got those first four areas sorted, then you know, you'll almost find it quite easy to set the future of your processes if you've really done those first four aspects.
Yeah, I think the last thing I'd add is just that it's, being from a digital agency, I think we've been guilty of bamboozling a lot of businesses with the possibilities of what technology can bring, and, you know, called sort of paralysis analysis. You know, you can really be sort of paralyzed by possibilities of what technology can do. You are the brand. You are the business. You know what you stand for, and you know what customers value. Your job is just to articulate what you want to deliver for your customers and the way the experience should work. Go to your technology partners or your agencies, and they'll say the answer is yes, we can build it, and we can build it quickly. If you go out with an RFP for a big new e-commerce site, it's going to take forever. Just describe what experience you want customers to have. Your agency partners or your in-house tech people will be able to build it very, very quickly. If you can articulate, I just want it to do this and not that, just it needs to do this, and I need it to do exactly this. Not what can I have? What can I have? Because you can have anything. You can have anything you want. So just describe what you want right now to service the most valuable customers right now, and get someone to build it for you and get it in market, learn from it, and do it again. And, you know, just build it, iterate. You know, I don't want to use the word agile, but just get it out into market and learn. Everyone's going to be more tolerant than ever of maybe a few missteps, but if you're trying and getting it out there. But, you know, I've seen so many examples of websites and e-commerce businesses popping up in weeks. The platforms are out there to support you, whether it be Shopify or BigCommerce or any of the ones that are out there. They can do it so quickly if you're willing to jump. Often it takes a quarter of the time to build any of these things than the time it takes you to decide to do it. The hardest thing is the decision to act, as Amelia Earhart once says. So just choose to do something and start doing it.